So let us see the mathematics of computer graphics. Computer graphics means mathematics only. So we'll be seeing the coordinate reference frames, the points and vectors, the basis vectors and the metric tensor, the matrices, various operations on matrices, and the complex numbers, the quaternions with non-parametric representations and parametric representations. So first of all, coordinate reference systems. So they are coordinate reference frames. They are two partitions of coordinate reference frames. First of all, Cartesian coordinate systems. In this, we have x, y, z, and x, y. This is a typical coordinate system in which you use the coordinate axis. While in non-Cartesian coordinate system, this is used for object representation in a special case, like polar, like spherical, cylindrical. So these cylindrical coordinate systems are being shown by non-Cartesian coordinate system. This is the 2D Cartesian reference system. In various system, various graphics, you will see like this. Because if you have this lower left, this is the lower left screen corner, the coordinates origin at this is at the lower left screen corner. While at the upper left, if you consider this to be, this one to be the upper left, this one upper left, then this will be 0, 0. Okay, this is like 0, 0. Okay, so the object lie here and we take 0, 0 here. Here we take 0, 0 here, the x-axis is here, and the y-axis grows like this. This is the 2D Cartesian reference frames with lower left and upper left screen corner. Then we have polar coordinates. What are these polar coordinates? These are most used non-Cartesian system. See, we have seen x, y, z. Now these are the most used non-Cartesian system. For example, if consider this, this is some point. Okay, this is r distance from here, and angle making theta with the this coordinate, this axis. So this will be, the projection is r cos theta here, and the projection here is y sin theta, sorry, r sin theta. So x cos theta and y sin theta. This x and y, you square and add them, you'll get r square is equal to x square plus y square. So r magnitude will be under root of x square plus y square. When the angle, if you divide these two, then theta will be tan inverse of y by x, s equal to r theta, right? So basic thing is that the this is non-Cartesian system, so we'll use for elliptical coordinate, hyperbolic, parabolic. These are the coordinate, these are can be expressed by other coordinates with symmetry beside the circle. So why we need the polar coordinates? First of all, you must ask this question, that if Cartesian were available, why we need this polar coordinate? See, in this a circle, if you want to represent a circle in this, okay, this is a kind of circle. In a circle, this is one of the coordinate of the circle. So in 2D Cartesian, it is unequal distribution. You will always have some dx distance. If you find xy here, this r, this xy r, there will be some dx. There will be some dx distance. So it will not be properly shown. While if we use the polar coordinate with the angle, this is theta, and we just take the point as r cos theta and y sin theta with respect to the angle, then the coordinates will be accurate. Now this is the 3D Cartesian reference frames. In this you see that this is a point P, which is some x square plus y square plus z square distance. The x is the distance from, this is x axis, y axis and z axis. So from y z axis, this is the x distance. From y z axis, this is the z distance. And from z x axis, this is the y distance. So this is the three dimensional point you can represent using the 3D Cartesian reference frames. And 3D Cartesian reference frames, you have generally, you know, in general graphic packages, you'll find this right hand coordinate system like this. If you put hand like this, the z axis will be pointing in the direction of your thumb. While if you want to show the video monitor or the observer coordinate system of video monitor, then the left hand coordinate system is convenient to show this. This is 3D curvilinear coordinate system, general curvilinear coordinate system, because what happens in 3D or in representation will not normally get the exact, you know, square type of figure. For that, we'll have the curvilinear reference frame. Then this will try to make the orthogonal coordinate system, or utilize the orthogonal coordinate system. What it means is that the each coordinate surfaces, they intersect at right angle. That is why it is orthogonal. This is say x1, x2, x3, these are cos 1, cos 2, cos 3, and these are the x-axis. See? x1 axis, these are the x's. So they are just curvilinear axes. This is a general curvilinear coordinate reference frame. Now, if we talk about the 3D non-Cartesian system, we have seen the Cartesian system. Let us see cylindrical coordinate. We can also have a spherical coordinate. in terms of if you want to represent it using the cylindrical coordinate, then this can be represented, any point can be represented as point rho theta z, where the x point here will be represented by rho cos theta, the angle theta you can see here, and y will be rho sin theta, and z will be equal to z only. While in spherical coordinate, because we are taking cylindrical, that is why we are taking z equal to z. But if you want to take the spherical coordinate, in this again r theta rho, it is represented by r theta rho. This is the phi angle, this is the theta angle, and this is the r distance. For that, the x, y, z will be represented by r cos theta sin phi, y will be equal to r sin theta sin phi, and z will be equal to r cos phi. How to represent the point? The point will be x and y. This will be represented by x, y. Any point will be represented by x, y, right? So point, it occupies one point in the coordinate system and it displays the position. So it can be just one point, right? It will be represented by the coordinate x, y. What about the vector? Vector is defined as the difference between two points. So if we have one more point, this is say x1, y1, and this is say x2, y2. So the difference between these two, that is the x2 minus x1 and y2 minus y1, we can represent x2 minus x1 by vx, y2 minus y1 by vy. So now we have two points, vx, vy. This is the magnitude and the direction. These are the magnitude and the directions of the vector. So magnitude can be computed by under root v square, vx square plus vy square, and the direction will be computed by 10 inverse vy by vx. Okay, this is how it is represented. Now the vectors, if 3D vector, dimension vector we need to represent, then we can have vx, vy, vz. Vx square plus vy square plus vz square will be the magnitude, and the angle cos alpha will be vx by magnitude of v, cos beta will be vy by magnitude of v, and cos gamma will be vz by v. The angle represent the actual angles. This is the v vector. And if we square and add the cos of these angles, we will get 1. We can also add these vectors, like if you want to add v1 and v2, then we can just do it by the x vector addition, y vector addition, z vector addition. We can also multiply by scalar, that is we just multiply alpha by v, so alpha vx, alpha vy, and alpha vz. Now the scalar product is nothing but the dot product, or you can also call it as an inner product. This is v1 vector, this is v2 vector, this is the angle between them, theta. So what you will get is, if this is v1, the projection of v2 will be v2 cos theta. So it is nothing but v1, v2 cos theta. V1 dot V2 will be equal to V1 V2 cos theta. Theta lies between 0 and pi, that is 180 degree. So for Cartesian reference frame, we can easily multiply it. V1 dot V2, multiply means, you know, there are various multiplication. This is a dot multiplication. So that will be X, Y, Z, and you just add them. Okay. The properties which it takes is, it is commutative, that is V1 dot V2 equal to V2 dot V1, and distributive also. V1 dot V2 plus V3 will be equal to V1 dot V2 plus v1 dot v3, like this. Now coming to the vector product v1 v2, in this vector product, if this is v1, this is v2 vector, then the vector product will be on the this direction, means perpendicular to the plane in which v1 and v2 lies. This is the plane of v1 v2, this is the perpendicular to the plane, or you can say v1 v2 will be equal to v1 v2 sin theta. Theta again lies between 0 and pi. So this is the cross product or outer product, we can say. So for Cartesian reference frame, v1 v2 will be nothing but v1 by v2z minus v1z v2y. Likewise, okay, all these three coordinates will be computed like this, not like the earlier version we have seen. So this property of this vector product is, it is anti-commutative. Means if v1 v2 we multiply, that is okay, means vector multiplication. But we multiply v2 minus v1, v2 into v1, that will be minus of v1 v2. That will be anti-commutative. Not associative, we cannot do it like this. Okay, we have to means we can just we have to multiply these two, then only we can multiply it like this. So the application of equality of this terms, that is multiplying this and by this, will give the same result, is not possible here. The distributive terms is property is possible. V1 cross V2, then you can add V1 cross V3, right? So for example, you have a scalar product. This is the angle between two edges. These are the two edges. You will just get v1, v2, and that is the scalar product. Now in the vector product, you will get the normal vector of the plane, right? So angle between two edges in scalar product and normal or perpendicular to the plane in which v1 and v2 lies will be your vector product. So now coming to basis vectors. Basis, this is basis vector means, or you can also call it as a set of base vectors. So in basis vector, it specify the coordinate axis in any reference frame. Specify the coordinate axis in any reference frame, and these are linearly independent set of vectors. Vectors which are linearly independent. So any other vector in that space can be written as a linear combination of them. V1, V2. So we can have a V3. It can be written in the combination of V1 and V2. This is the curvilinear coordinate axis vectors we have just seen in the previous discussion. In a vector space, this can contain scalars also and vectors also. Scalar vector we have already seen, and the dimension will be the number of base vectors. Orthonormal basis. What is the orthonormal basis? In the orthonormal basis, we have normal basis plus orthogonal basis. So if these are two vectors uk dot uk, that will be equal to 1. If they are similar, then they will be equal to 1 for all k, any k. And if they are different, uj dot uk, then it will be equal to 0 for all j which is not equal to k. J and k should not be equal, otherwise they will be equal to 1. For example, the orthonormal basis, because orthonormal basis of 2D Cartesian reference frame will be ux equal to say 1 0, uy will be equal to 0 1. This is how the orthonormal basis of 2D Cartesian reference frame will be seen. And on the orthonormal basis for 3D Cartesian reference frame, if ux is 1 0 0, uy will be 0 1 0, and uz will be 0 0 1. This is the orthonormal basis. What about metric tensor? What is metric tensor? First, we'll see the tensor. The quantity having a number of components depending on the tensor rank and the dimension of the space. So vector means tensor of rank 1, scalar means tensor of rank 0. Let me tell you again, tensor, the quantity having a number of components depending on the tensor rank and the dimension of the space. Vector is tensor of rank 1, scalar is a tensor of rank 0. Symmetric tensor of any general coordinate system will be rank 2, elements will be symmetric, and this will be given by gjk equal to uj dot uk. And gjk will be equal to gkj also. What is the properties of metric tensors? The element of metric tensor can be used to determine the distance, first of all, between two points in that space, and the transformation equation for conversion to another space. So you can have distance also, transformation equations also, and the components of various differential vector operators like radians and divergence and curl within that space can also be computed. These are the properties of metric tensors. These are the example of metric tensors. If you see the Cartesian coordinate system, ux you know 1 0, so uy will be 0 1. Gjk will be 1 if j equal to k, as we have seen. Otherwise, if j is not equal to k, that will be always 0. So the polar coordinates will be given by ur and u theta. Ur will be ux cos theta plus uy sin theta. U theta will be given by minus ux r sin theta plus uy r cos theta. These are the polar coordinates. And g will be given by 1 by 1, this is the matrix, 1 0 0 r square. Okay. Now we come to matrix, or one or more matrix is called matrices. The definition is the rectangular array of quantities. This is a matrix. Okay. See, these are rows, these are columns. These are rows, and these are columns. So any representation in the form of rows and column, these are called matrices. So the scalar multiplication and matrix addition will be, if you want to multiply matrix, first of all, then this will be A11, B11, then A12, B21. This is how it is being multiplied. And the first value will be written here. Then the KA, see, this is 2 by 2 matrix, and this is 2 by 2 matrix. So this will cancel, this always gets cancelled out. The final matrix will be of the order of 2 by 2. This is a metric order, right? So this, for example, this metric is the order of M by N, because there are m rows and n columns. If you want to multiply any value to the matrix, say you want to multiply some scalar k, then this will be multiplied to all the values which are inside. In matrix multiplication, if this is A into B, these are two matrix AB, then this will be nothing but sigma k equal to n aik bkj, right? See, in the previous one, we have seen that we can just easily add it, okay? I showed you the multiplication. The multiplication is in the next slide. But A11 plus B11, this is addition. Simply, this is addition. So A11 plus B11, A12 plus B12, as you can see. But the multiplication I showed can be seen here with this formula. And the way I showed you is like this only. First, we multiply this by this plus this by this. Then this by this plus this by this. And we place it here. So the properties is of matrix multiplication is, it is non-commutative. That means A into B not be equal to B into A. Matrix multiplication. Associative, yes, it is associative. You can compute AB, then multiply it by C, or you can compute A, then multiply B and C. Distributive also, distributive, you know, AB plus AC, BC. This should be AC, sorry. AB plus AC. In the scalar multiplication is always, you know, K can be anywhere. You can multiply K with A, or you can multiply K with B, or you can compute AB, then multiply it with K. So all these are okay. What about transpose? Transpose is just interchanging of rows and columns. If you can see the example, these are the 1, 2, 3, these are the rows, 4, 5, 6 are rows. In this case, when we apply this transpose, 1, 2, 3 will become 1, 2, 3. So the row has become the column, first column. The second row has become this column. So the transpose is like this. Rows will become column. And transpose of matrix follow one more rule, that A, B transpose will be equal to, first we'll take B transpose and then A transpose. Then determinant of matrix. Determinant means for a square matrix. See, if you want to find the determinant, it has to be a square matrix. Means n by n. You cannot compute the determinant of a non-square matrix. So for a square matrix, combining the matrix element to a product, you can find a single number. This is a 2x2 matrix. This is 2x2 matrix. You can compute A11 multiplied by AD2, and then A21 multiplied by A12, and this you can take the subtraction. And the determinant of n by n matrix will be, for n which should be greater than or equal to 2, this will be equal to minus 1 to the power I j plus k. J and k are nothing but the subscripts, say a11, a12. So this I and j we are talking about. Every time we are going to compute this, we will place the this value, which are the matrix inputs, and then we will find the determinant of a j k. This is the determinant of n by n. And what about the inverse of a matrix? If you want to compute the inverse of a matrix, that is A inverse is equal to I. See, this is an example. You can easily compute A, this one, A inverse equal to I. So if A is a matrix and you have a inverse, then they will give you a identity matrix. And if A inverse A is also there, then it will also give you identity matrix. What about non-singular matrix? If and only if the determinant of the matrix is non-zero, then you will get the non-singular matrix. What about 2x2 matrix? Just take an example, 2x2 matrix. So A inverse will be, first of all, we'll take the cofactors of this, and then AD minus BC will divide it by the determinant of the matrix. So this is how we compute the inverse of the matrix. So the properties of inverse of the matrix will be, A inverse of inverse will be A. AB inverse will be first B inverse, A inverse. Transpose of inverse will be, can be interchanged. This can come inside, this can go out. So inverse of transpose. Now we come to the complex number. Complex number is of the form z equal to x plus i1, this one, where this x is the real part, y is the imaginary part. So complex number will have real part and imaginary part. This I is nothing but I square is equal to minus 1. And this is the point z, which is represented by x plus I by x is this real axis and y is an imaginary axis. The addition would be, if you want to add this x1, y1, x2, y2, you just add this. And here you, y plus y. You can easily add the real part and imaginary part. That's what I want to say. Scalar multiplication is also like this. You just multiply k by x1, y1. These are x1, y1 for you, any x1, y1. Multiplication will be, see, multiplication of two z values means z1, z2, these are two complex numbers. This will be x1, x2 minus y1, y2, and then x1, y2 plus x2, y1. What about pure imaginary number and complex conjugate? See, I told you that I is represented by 0, 1. This is the imaginary unit. So I square will be equal to 0, 1, 0, 1, that is minus 1. So I square is nothing but minus 1. The complex conjugate of z is equal to x plus iy will be equal to x minus iy. X plus iy, you simply change plus to minus, that will be complex conjugate. The modulus or absolute value will be represented by this. This is nothing but the summation of the imaginary part and real part. Real part and imaginary part. What about the division? Z1 by Z2. And you can apply Z1, Z2. You can place the Z2 bar and Z2 bar. And you can compute these two. And finally, the result will be like this. X1, X2 plus Y1, Y2 by X2 square plus Y2 square. Same denominator here. In this case, you will have X2, Y1 minus X1, Y2. This is the division. What about the representation with polar coordinates? See, we have z equal to r cos theta plus I sin theta. This is the representation of real part. So you have real part also, imaginary part also. But now we are representing with respect to the polar coordinates. Z is equal to xy. This is the theta, this is the r. So this is the real axis, this is the imaginary axis. Same as the representation z we have seen just now. But now we are representing it using the polar coordinate. So z is equal to r cos theta plus I sin theta. That is, r is outside. We will use the Euler formula, that is e to the power I theta. That will be equal to cos theta plus I sin theta. So z is nothing but r e to the power I theta. This is r, and e to the power theta, this is e to the power I theta, cos theta plus I sin theta. Now you can easily do the complex multiplication division, z1, z2, so r1, r2, e to the power I, theta and theta will be added, theta 1 plus theta 2, and z1 by z2, theta will be subtracted, r1 by r2, e to the power I, theta 1 minus theta 2. You can also compute the nth root, that is the nth root will be n, the nth root of under root square, under r means n root of r, and then you can have cos theta plus 2k pi by n plus I sin theta plus 2k pi by n, k can vary from 0 to n minus 1. What about this quaternions that has the one real part and you have three imaginary part, one real part and three imaginary part. The properties will be I square, j square, k square will be equal to minus 1. And the property of ij, jk and ki will be equal to minus ji, jk will be minus kj and ki will be minus ik, but all will ij will represent the k, jk will represent the I and ki represent the j. What about the addition and scalar multiplication? If you want to do the addition, you can add the s1, s2 part, this two part, then a part, then b part, then c part, like c1 plus c2. If you want to multiply a scalar value, d, you can multiply it everywhere. This is quaternions. The ordered pair notation, if you have a scalar s and a vector v, okay, this is a scalar s and these are vector v. So you can have a ordered pair q with s and v, s comma v, scalar vector. Addition will be q1 plus q2, s1 plus s2, the scalar part and the vector part. Multiplication can be done like this, q1 q2, that is the s1 s2 minus v1 dot v2, then s1 v2 plus s2 v1 plus v1 v2, vector part. Magnitude will be, of q will be s square plus v dot v. The inverse will be 1 by q square s comma v. That will be q inverse will be equal to q inverse q, where you know what it gives, it will give you an identity matrix. Then 3D rotation. Because in 3D, various rotation will be there. For a 3D point, say alpha, beta, gamma, this you can have, it's called its conjugate, right? Like q, if it is like w, x, y, z, and we can have its conjugate like this, w minus x minus y minus z, the conjugate of q is like this. So a unit of quaternion will be like this, 0 alpha beta gamma dot q bar, that will be equal to 0 alpha bar beta bar gamma bar. So rotating this alpha beta gamma by say angle 2 theta about the axis parallel to ABC, or we can see that q will be equal to cos theta plus sin theta ABC. So RQ, this is RQ, which is a 3D rotation about ABC, this ABC by 2 theta. So RQ will be represented by q p q bar. Okay, q p q bar. What about the non-parametric representation? First of all, we have these object descriptions directly in terms of the coordinate of the reference frame. For example, you can have an implicit expression like this, fxyz equal to 0. You can have an explicit expression like z equal to fxy. These are the two object descriptions which are directly in terms of the coordinate of the reference frame. The advantage is it is very useful in describing the objects, but the disadvantage is the change in the independent variables as derivatives, they change. So implicit versus explicit equations, implicit is x square plus y square is equal to z square, and y, in this case, explicit equation, we have y equal to under root r square minus x square. Parametric representation is, this is 3D curve with parameter u, pu is equal to xu, yu, zu. So xu will be r cos 2 pi u, yu will be r sin 2 pi u, zu will be equal to 0, so u which is in between 0 to 1. For parameter u, this is the 3D curve, and 3D surfaces with say some parameter uv, puv, these are the curves, okay, and these are the surfaces. So for surface you have point uv, for 3D curves you have just point u. For xuv you have this value, y you have this value, z you have this value, where u is greater than equal to 0, v is greater than equal to 1. This is the representation, 3D surface representation with parameters and 3D curve representation. So these were few mathematics about your computer graphics, and don't worry if you are not able to understand few of them, we'll be covering it and we'll be explaining it whenever it is required. But the basic knowledge of your elementary mathematics is quite required in computer graphics. Thank you so much. Take care.